Welcome to all of you in this second of a series of sharing stories of our neighbors. So he's owner of El Tequila Latin Kitchen, which is, I think, in our neighborhood here somewhere. Yeah. On Central Avenue, right? Is it on Central Avenue? Yeah, Central Avenue. And he is a member of the Columbia Heights Police Multicultural Advisory Committee. That's a very good thing that you're doing. Thanks for helping out in the community here. And he migrated from Ecuador in 92 with his mother and sisters to join his father, who migrated here in the 80s. Huh? Yeah, in the 80s. So welcome, and thank you for sharing your story.
Well, I'm going to start like saying hola, everyone. Hola a todos. I'm going to do like the Spanglish, like, I don't know if you heard that term. But I want to tell my story a little bit. I'm going to start like back from as far as I can remember. I used to follow up my dad's steps, like trying to be a good father, trying to support his family, trying to become something he couldn't be when he was younger, because he had not as much opportunities as we have right now these days, I would say. He used to work as a security guard, probably thinking about like 1981, 82. That's, I don't know, I keep telling my mom that I do remember things like when I was 5 or 6 years old. She doesn't think that's true, but I don't know, I have a faint memory of how things used to be back then. And then, because of the economy and everything, he had to emigrate here to the United States back in 1986. He left a big gap in the family. You could imagine, like, my mom with five little kids, you know, trying to survive on her own. My father, back in those days, the time it would take for them to travel from Ecuador to the United States of America, it would be like a month or two sometimes. Like, you wouldn't hear about them. Like, you really, like, you would like just be crossing your fingers, hoping that they would show signs of life somewhere along the way, along the time. And it was very hard. Once he got here, he started working, sending money, sending letters, sending tapes. He used to be back in the days when we used to have the audio tapes. He would send tapes, like recording with his voice, telling us how things are, sending us pictures. You know, in our heads, we would think like, oh gosh, he's in heaven. Like, look at those beautiful pictures. Like, there are lakes, there are flowers. Even like the snow would look awesome. Like, we'd be like, I want to be in the snow like he is. So then time went by. My mom also decided that he wanted to join him, which was another, that was the hardest thing, I probably say. Like, you know, your dad he shares a part of your heart, but your mom, I think, she's your everything. So she moved here, around 88, 89, and it was so hard. Like, I don't know how she made it through. Like, I think about like the way families are, like my family, my wife, my kids, and I cannot, feel what she felt back then, going away, leaving your kids behind. My grandma was still alive, but I just think that wasn't the same. That wasn't enough for us, for the kids that we were left behind. She went back a couple years afterwards. She stayed there until finally my dad was able to get a green card and apply for us so that we can all move back here. So that was back in 92. We came in the middle of the winter, January 27th, I remember. I will never forget the date. My first place, I guess my first state and city that I lived into was Manhattan, New York City. So picture me, a person that used to live in a place where I could do whatever I want. I can go to school, come back, swim in the river. There was a little river. I can just swim in there for a couple hours and go back home, have some lunch, and enjoy the rest of my day, doing whatever I want, doing my homework. That was like my thing. And then come here and be thrown into a big city where everything was crazy. Like, they could feel like looking at everybody were like ants, like just running around, like getting into the buildings. So it was a big change, like a very hard for me to adjust in my family. And like what he mentioned, like I would be like really like depressed and crying like under my blankets, but I wouldn't tell my parents. I wouldn't make them feel bad. They already went through so much. We were in debt because we had to borrow money to come here. So I just kept it to myself for as far as I can. I don't think I was even legal to work here. I got here when I was 16, so I started working like around 16 and a half before I became 17. I started working for a factory. We used to make leather bags, wallets. We used to cut leather with those big machines, and it was very hard. I don't know, like thinking back in time, like I give myself a pat on the back and like, good job, you went through so much, and I managed to go through all those feelings, through all those stages of my life. Then I went back to school, got my GED, got into a technical career institute. I got some English classes, writing classes, reading classes, until I started working in a restaurant. That's where everything comes, like where I am right now. So you start from the basics, you start doing being a dishwasher, become a prep person, become a cook, become a manager, become a server, become a bartender. So I pretty much think that life prepares you. You just have to go along with it, not fight against it. It seems like at that moment it's hard, like you waking up at 5 or 6 in the morning, it's hard, like why do I do this? But I think everything has a purpose in life, while you're doing things. So I think that helped me. I think make me the person I am right now. It was probably hard. But I think like the metal, like, you know, sometimes you have to heat it up and hear it very hard to make it become something useful. So then we decided to move to Minnesota in 2001, right after the Twin Towers, you know, they fell down. We already had plans to come here, and then it happened in November, and October. Then we moved here in November, and I felt like guilty, like, okay, I'm leaving the city that welcomed me and gave me so many opportunities. Now I'm going to Minnesota. So now here I am in Minnesota, 16 years ago. Same thing, kind of starting all over again, looking for a job, looking for, okay, what I'm gonna do here. So I went work, bought a house. I tried everything. I tried to be a real estate agent. Then the housing market crashed. I tried to be a loan officer. Then the housing market crashed. I went back to MCTC. I took my my 3-year construction electricity diploma. Then we decided to open a restaurant back in 2006 in South Minneapolis. So we opened up a restaurant. Everything was going great. Only thing, we had partners, so we didn't get along too well. I decided to split up. I'm going to try it with my family. We opened another restaurant with my family. But the same thing, you know, too many heads doing one thing, it's a little hard to. My last project is here with my wife. That we opened the restaurant down on 40th and Central. It's called El Tequila. We've been there for 4 years, almost 5 years. I still do my construction when I can. I help people as much as I can. I like the fact that I'm bringing people something that they like, either by cooking a dish, or either by fixing a light, or either by helping someone who I see that's in need on the street. Like I see somebody who's not being able to cross the street, or somebody who's like not being able to express themselves because they either don't speak English to a Spanish person, or because they don't speak Spanish to an English speaking person. So either way, I think we're blessed by speaking two languages. You know, we count as two people. I don't know, maybe I'm just telling myself, but I think like we had that advantage, and I'm very grateful for that, that we never lost our roots. You know, I can go somewhere and eat a hot dog, and I can go somewhere and eat a taco, and I'm okay with either way. Yeah, so I think that's a great thing I can say about being a Latino, and also have grown into the culture that's here in the United States.